Okay, this video is titled "They're Not All Good," and it was kind of prompted by a question that we had on YouTube. This is actually a title and idea for a blog to write that I've had for a good while, but well, the videos are just so much faster and easier to shoot. So, welcome to my laziness. This is just, I guess the last few videos have all been sort of about keeping it real and giving a little dose of insight of what I see in the horse world and where some of the large problems lie. And this is one of those areas. And I'm going to read the question midway through the video because not all of this video really pertains to this gentleman's question. So horses, people tend to romanticize and anthropomorphize about horses a lot. And anthropomorphism is assigning human traits and characteristics to animals. I very commonly use human examples to give people insight into relationships with horses. I would never want anyone to think that means that I believe or that horses in fact have the same types of emotions and feelings and all that people have. They do not. They absolutely do not. I have seen horses do things that are quite human. I've seen horses mourn when they have a pasture mate die. I have seen, fairly seldom, mind you, but I have seen relationships with horses that were very strong between people and horses. But the vast majority of the time when I'm working with someone that insists that this horse loves them, the reality is that horse tolerates them at best, and sometimes not even that. So what we do see an awful lot of time with people is what I call the unicorn stage, and this is probably the majority of horse owners and certainly the majority of new horse owners. And these are people that in their subconscious, when they look at Old Sorrel over there, they don't really see Old Sorrel. They see a gray uniform in the moonlight in front, a unicorn in the moonlight in front of the forest out there, and that's what their subconscious is really projecting onto Old Sorrel. The fact that Old Sorrel bit him twice last week and bucked him off three times last month doesn't factor into that picture. And until it does and they really see Old Sorrel for Old Sorrel and the pig that he can be sometimes, they're never going to improve. So, you know, while it's fun and romantic to be in the unicorn stage, it's not realistic, it's not helpful. Probably the most dangerous time that you are in the horse world out there, because you are just so wrong about what is really going on with the horse. And look, I love horses. You know, I didn't do this for a living on accident. But I'm realistic about what they are and what they aren't. And that's pretty darn key. If you're going to try to work with a horse and actually get that animal to improve and do these things that we want them to do, you can't work with a mythical creature. You have to work with the creature that's actually standing in front of you here. So under the title of "They're Not All Good," there's going to be two main types of horses that I'm going to talk about here. The first one is the mismatched horse, and this is kind of where the majority of these types of problems come in. First of all, just let me say that for the love of Pete, if you are a green new rider into the horse world, or if a lot of people rode when they were a kid but then they had a family and they haven't ridden for 30 years and now they're getting back into it, for the love of Pete, do not go buy a green horse. I beg of you, please do not do that. It's job security. I know that a lot of people are not going to listen, and hey, it's what we make our living off of, but It is not a good idea. It is a very, very, very bad idea. While you are learning, you are not capable of offering the type of leadership and support to a horse that really, really needs it, like a green horse. You need to develop those skills and get that understanding and, you know, have confidence built on successes before you're ready to offer that to a green horse. It is always a bad idea to put a green rider on a green horse. Now, there comes a time when a rider isn't so green anymore and they've maybe moved up to an intermediate type stage, and now a horse that's got 90 days of professional training or something, or a couple of years of trail riding under his belt, but he still needs to learn some finer points of riding. You know, now that rider's maybe ready to handle a horse like that, and they're going to get even more confidence by teaching that horse something. But whenever you start off in the horse world, you're not even going to be capable of keeping a horse where it is. One of the dressage ladies that I help out, she had a pretty neat little statement that if, you know, you dropped her in a Grand Prix level dressage horse off on a desert island together, in 2 months you'd have a really nice training level horse. And that's because she's a training level rider, and that horse is going to come right down to her. And it's very true, and it's kind of laughable, and I love that she has that sort of a sense of humor about herself and where she is. But that's just reality. That horse is only going to ever be as good as you are. And so for new riders who don't have their skills built up, you know, the horse you ride is probably actually going to decrease in value and skill level and ability and all that for you having ridden. As you get to be a more advanced rider, or not a more intermediate level rider, now you're probably capable of getting on a horse and at least keeping him at the same level, or maybe improving him a little bit. And then as you become an advanced rider, now you can really train a horse and you can take one, you know, through the stages, and every single ride he's going to be better for you having ridden him. But you certainly don't start there. That's years down the road. So what we see very commonly is a rider who is mismatched with the horse. They've got a horse that needs this much support, and they're capable of giving this much support, and the gap between the two is just too much to cross. I will say that as I've been working with the public more these last few years, it has really opened my eyes to a lot of things. And in a sense, it has really made the relationship with the horse a little more romantic for me. The things that I see horses tolerate and fill in for people is really amazing. There's a whole lot more of you that should be on the ground on a regular basis than what really are. They're amazing creatures. They really are. But they are not unicorns. Another thing that we'll see sometimes, you may have a person who is financially quite well off and can afford to kind of go buy any kind of horse that they want as they get into the horse world. Sometimes that's a dangerous situation too, because they wind up buying a horse that is a little too high performance for what their skill level and the development of their seat and balance and all of that can handle. You wouldn't take a 15-year-old kid and start teaching them how to drive in a Ferrari. I mean, that is a wreck waiting to happen. And it's kind of the same way. You don't need to learn to ride on a open level competition horse that's going to be very, very sensitive, because the little things that you do wrong are going to be way magnified in a horse like that. Just stay kind of simple and basic, and with a horse that's not too exciting in the beginning. But you'll get your skill levels and all, a couple years down the road, you'll be ready to move on to another horse and kind of keep climbing the ladder that way. But there's a lot of people that start off with too green of a horse, or a horse that just needs a way more experienced rider. And, you know, they have a few wrecks, they get hurt, and now they're out of the horse business. And you know, this is really where the unwanted horse problem begins. That horse is now going to be labeled something pretty unfairly. He now has hurt someone. And it really probably wasn't his fault. But now, with the way the horse market is, the economics of it all, you know, that's one that's going to now become neglected and wind up in a rescue or go to slaughter or whatever. It's really not fair to the horse to be in that overly romanticized stage about what you think you're going to go accomplish. So now we will get to the actual question that began all of this. And let me read it exactly as he has, how he has it here. He says that he has a horse that is scared and runs into fences. And when he holds her back, she bucks until she lays down. What can he do? Whew. Okay. So this doesn't sound like a problem of a mismatched rider or someone who's gotten in over his head. This sounds like a pretty legitimate problem horse to me. I'm going to just say at the beginning of this, in case I lose anybody, I know people don't tend to watch videos all the way through. There are, absolutely unequivocally, there are unfixable horses out there. I do kind of have a few points here that I want to make, but let's just look at it this way. We have people who are born not right. And I don't mean this in a condescending way, or I'm not trying to offend anybody. I'm just, again, just trying to talk about reality. I have volunteered quite a bit with a therapeutic riding group around here, and the particular group that I work with was autistic kids, and I did that for a couple of years. And within autism, there's a scale. You have kids that are fairly low functioning and are going to need 24-hour care for the rest of their life, and then you have other kids more on the Asperger's type end of the scale that are just maybe a little socially or emotionally more challenged, but they're going to be able to go to college and live independent lives and so forth. But I guess the point is that you can't romanticize about that kid and what they're going to do. You have to look at where they really are and how you can properly challenge them. And the kids on this end of the spectrum can't be held to the same bar that the kids on this end of the spectrum can be held to. With people, we also have like schizophrenics. You can't just go and expect that person to function the same way. I mean, it's an unfortunate part of the homeless situation that we've got here in the United States, but I mean, mental illness exists, and there are many reasons for it, but there are definitely a small percentage of animals born that are similar to that you can't hold to the same bar, that they're not going to perform the same way. And it's not anybody's fault, and it's not something that can be fixed by anybody, no matter how talented or skilled they are. I'll tell you, I mean, personally, I have dealt with thousands of horses. I have had about 8 or 10 throughout that career that I really don't think anybody could have fixed. And they've been throughout the career. So I've had a couple, within the last couple of years, I had one that flipped over on me. It was within a year of me starting horses. That kind of fit into that category too. They exist, and it doesn't matter how experienced you are, whether you're pretty green, whether Ray Hunt himself or Tom or Bill Dorrance got their hands on the horse. It doesn't exist within that horse to be typical. So they do exist. They're not all good, and I really shouldn't say good about those horses. It's not their fault that they're that way, but they tend to be pretty dangerous, and it's just not worth getting somebody hurt to try to, you know, make something out of them that they're just not ever going to be. So the typical problem horse, there's kind of three horses that I wanted to have in mind here for y'all, and I want to just share another little bit of reality with you. With every single horse that I put in a round pen to start, or if I get a problem horse in to ride or whatever, one of the things that I'm going to do with them, and it's, if you've looked at my groundwork stuff, it's my second deal of my goals of groundwork, it's to poke that horse and push them until they kind of explode. If you are a follower of Ray Hunt and Tom and Bill, this is what they would have called overexposed. And it's when you push that horse past his threshold and he just can't handle it anymore and you have a wreck. It is honestly, it's not the kind of thing I would generally say in front of a crowd, but when I put a horse in a round pen, somewhere between me entering that round pen and me sitting my butt in that saddle for the first ride, I'm going to purposefully push that horse about as far as I can and see what happens. I want to know how bad it's going to get if it gets bad, and I want to know how easy or difficult it is to get that horse to that point. So we may have one particular horse in that round pen that I just really have to push, and I'm huffing and puffing and kind of have to get a little devious in my mind to do anything that really upsets that animal. On the other end of the spectrum, we might have a horse that I come in there and I really am not even, I had a horse one time, I was standing outside of the round pen and was just kind of getting my stuff ready. He was loose in the round pen and I took a saddle and just tossed it up onto the rail, and that caused that horse, he's 40 feet away, he jumped out of the round pen on the other side just from that small action. I wasn't interacting with him at all, wasn't in the pen with him at all. Some are hypersensitive. Now, you better believe when I saw that horse react that strongly to that little bit of stimulus that I was going to be very, very careful with that animal thereafter. And then we might have a horse that's somewhere in the middle that I have to push on a little bit and kind of have to try to provoke him and to get that blow up, but then that horse settles right down and gets better, and now I can't make him do that anymore. That's really the kind of horse that I'm looking for personally. The first horse that we talked about there, that would be more the mentality that we would want for the beginning rider, but that's going to be a horse that's not very sensitive either, and the performance level that you're going to get out of him is going to be diminished. The hypersensitive horse on the other end of the spectrum, that's going to be a horse that it's going to take you a long, long time, 10 times longer than the average type of a horse, to get them settled down enough where, you know, the two of you can be relaxed and you can trust that horse and go forward. So, you know, look for balance in everything. Now back to the unfixable type horse. There's a few characteristics of that horse that I wanted to talk about. So the first one is whenever you're working with a problem horse or colt, what you're kind of doing is, with those things that I'm talking about, provoking the horse, you're looking for triggers. You're looking for some specific stimulus that horse has a problem with. It could be you standing on the left side back here by his flank. Maybe he really doesn't like you right there. It could be a tarp. When he hears the sound of a tarp crinkle, it sets him off a little bit. It could be flagging at him. It could be, you know, a whole bunch of things. Could be anything. You know, water. Horses don't want to cross a creek or whatever. That's that stimulus that they have a problem with that kind of triggers them to start acting up. That's what you're looking for. When you can find what the trigger is, now you can work on desensitizing it and you can address it specifically. These types of horses that you're not going to get fixed, you won't ever find a specific trigger. It's going to be something different all the time. So you can never kind of feel like you're safe and you're okay because this isn't around right now. It could be anything at any time. It's these horses tend to have wrecks really out of the blue. The second part of that is the time frame. So one of the things that I'm looking for, that I've kind of used as a benchmark throughout my career, is the 2-week mark. So when I'm starting a colt and the owner wants to come ride it, what I'm kind of looking for is that I've had 2 weeks on this colt without a wreck. And that's when I feel like this colt is kind of settling in and we've got a pattern of good rides now and things are are likely going to be okay and go smooth from this point forward. When I've had a little while with a horse and everything seems to be going fine, and then the next day I get them out and it's like the last 2 weeks didn't happen. And there are horses like that, that it's just like their little slate gets wiped clean every once in a while. That's going to be one of these types that you can't really fix. And I really believe that's more of a physiological type of a thing that has nothing to do with training or behavior manipulation or any of that kind of stuff. It's just, you know, that's that horse that kind of has a screw loose. I can remember one particular mare that I had probably 6 or 7 years ago, and she was a tough rascal. She had skint herself up. This man's talking about a horse that's running into walls and stuff. She was that type. I mean, it was, she was a danger to be around. And we had finally had about a week or 10 days where it kind of looked like we were past that stuff. And I had, you know, I was in contact with the owner and was telling him how things were going. And the next day, I go to get her out of her paddock, and it literally took me 2 hours to get her from the paddock up to where I would have saddled her. I mean, everything was too much for her. She didn't want to leave. You know, it was just a great big old wreck way before we even got to riding. That's the sort of stuff that I'm looking for to be a big red flag that you know, we're wasting our time and money on this one. The third thing about these types of horses is that they tend to always have an extreme reaction. So this gentleman who's talking about a horse that runs into walls, it bucks really hard anytime you try to take control of her, and then she finally lays down when that doesn't work. This is an animal that's going into fight or flight. And fight or flight, that's a nervous system response. If you ever hear of people who had an interaction, maybe they were mugged or something and you can't hardly remember what happened through there, that's when your environment gets so extreme that you kind of consciously shut down and your body just starts going through the motions. Or if you have someone who gets into that temporary insanity kind of a situation and they kill somebody or they beat them to death, but then they don't remember how. That's the same sort of thing. They weren't really conscious when that went on. And very extreme things tend to happen in those circumstances. So, like Tom and Bill and Ray, they talk an awful lot about a horse's sense of self-preservation. These horses are going to fight so hard that they're likely going to hurt themselves more in the fight than you know, anything that would have happened. So like a horse that's running into walls, or flipping over backwards, throwing themselves down on the ground, this is not a conscious thinking horse. This is not a horse that's thinking about self-preservation. This is a horse that's going somewhere off in his head, and there is no telling what they might do. But it's always going to be very, very extreme. And again, I do want y'all to understand that this type of horse that I'm talking about, like, this is the less than 0.1% kind of a horse, or very, very small fraction of the population. The vast majority of the horses that I get in that are crazy or whatever, you know, it's really not that big of a deal. But they do exist that can't be fixed. And I don't know some of the major clinicians that really are on this whole my program will fix everything deal, but that's marketing BS. So, you know, the guys that I know, my peers, when we're talking personally, we share stories about these kind of horses. They're the ones that give you your scars and your good stories to tell 20 years down the road. We all know that they exist. They can't all be fixed. You know, that's the reality of it. Anybody that's telling you that their deal can fix every single horse without question, you know, they're selling unicorns, and you need to be aware of that. Okay. So that's sort of, they're not all good. An important concept, I think, I think I think reality is a very big deal, and it's something that we have to be aware of. We are fooling with big animals that can be very reactive and can get you hurt. And, you know, darn sure better not be playing with a unicorn out there. All right. I guess that's enough on this today. Again, this is Daniel Dauphin with Dauphin Horsemanship. Thanks a bunch, and we hope that helps.